Welcome to Leader IS in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai. Myself, Professor Suhas Sargar. In today's this audio book, we all are going to learn State Board of Maharashtra, Standard 9th, Chapter Number 3rd, India's Internal Challenges. So let's begin. In this chapter, we all are going to learn about the some internal challenges that India faces. We shall see some internal challenges like separatist movement, issues of Northeast India, Naxalism, communalism and regionalism, the unrest in Punjab. Akali Dal was the major political party in Punjab. In 1973, the Akali Dal passed the Anandpur Sahib resolution. The following demands were made in this resolution. Chandigarh should be made a part of Punjab. The Punjabi speaking parts in other states should be included in the state of Punjab. Recruitment of the people from Punjab in the Indian Army should be increased, and more autonomy should be given to the state of Punjab. Akali Dal came to power in Punjab in 1977. While taking the charge, they asked for the larger share of the river's water from Punjab, holy cities, statues, status for Amritsar, etc., along with their old demands. In 1980, the movement for the independent Khalistan took root in the Punjab. During that period, the leader of Akali Dal was a son, Harcharan Singh Langowal. He used to direct his activists from the Golden Temple to stage protests. On other side of the Golden Temple, armed followers started gathering around the staunch Khalistan supporters, Sant Jarnail Singh Bindrewala. During that period, the terrorist activity had begun. Bindrewala was arrested in 1981, accused of the murder of newspaper editors. Laga Jagat Narayan. After this incident, the situation worsened due to these developments. President rule was imposed in Punjab in 1983. Bindrewala went to stay at the religious place called Akal Takht. The Bindrewala's followers captured the Golden Temple and built a barricade and sent bags over there. The area looked like a fort, and this greatly disturbed the peace in Punjab. It was a major challenge to the Indian democracy. Operation Blue Star. The main task of getting the terrorists out of the Golden Temple was entrusted to the Major General Kuldeep Singh Brar on the morning of 3rd June 1984. The mission Operation Blue Star started. The operation ended on 6 June. In this military operation, the Indian Army functioned with a great restraint. The operation ended with the death of Bindrewala and the other terrorists in 1986. An operation had to be conducted against the terrorists in the Golden Temple once more. It was called Operation Black Thunder. After this action was taken, the process of establishment of the peace in Punjab picked up the momentum. In box. Do you know the military expedition taken up with the peculiar objectives is called Operation? Operation Blue Star was an operation undertaken to evict the terrorists hiding in the Golden Temple. Box over. Issues concerning the Northeast India. Northeast India consists of the 8 states of Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, Sikkim, and Tripura. International borders of India touch each of the states to the varying extent. These states are different with respect to the ethnicity, language and cultural diversity. The first Prime Minister of India took the lead bringing the tribes living in these areas into the mainstream of country. In 1954, he formed the Northeast Frontier Agency, that is NEFA area, comprising of the territories on the Sino-Indian border and tribal areas towards the north of Assam. Nehru took the position of bringing about the development of hundreds of tribes in these parts while preserving their culture. The special provision has been made with respect to these areas in the 6th schedule of the Indian Constitution. 1965, the responsibility of administering these areas was given to the Ministry of External Affairs and the Northeastern Council Act of 1971. The supposed to advise the central government. In 1965, the responsibility of administering this area was given to the Ministry of External Affairs. The Northeast Council Act of 1971 was supposed to advise the central government regarding the aspect of common interest in the economic social sphere, interstate transport, electricity, food control, etc. Leader IAS in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai, Suhas Sargar. Mizoram. The tribes in the Northeast India have an ancient history. When India became independent, the government gave the administrative autonomy to the district of Mizo majority areas of the Lausi Lushai Hills. When the State Reorganization Commission was appointed in 1954, the expectation of the people in this area grew. The Mizo leaders started demanding an autonomous Mizo province in 1959. The territory of Mizoram experienced a severe drought. During this famine, the Mizo leader Lal Denga served the common people a lot. In 1961, Lal Denga established an organization called Mizo National Front. He asked for a greater Mizoram, an independent nation carved out of Tripura, Manipur, and Mizo majority areas from the Lushai Hills. In March 1966, the Mizo National Front announced the emergence of independent Mizoram. Prime Minister Indira Gandhi handled the situation firmly and suppressed the rebellions. When the situation calmed down in 1972, the Mizo majority area was given the status of Union Territory in 1985. Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi had an agreement with the Mizo National Front and the Mizoram was given the status of a full-fledged state. Lal Denga became the Chief Minister of the state. Nagaland, the Naga tribes in the Northeast India is known as a marital martial tribes. The Naga tribe had settled in eastern Himalaya, the Naga hills, border areas of Assam and Myanmar. In 1946, some educated Naga youth established an organization called Naga National Council. Later, they made a demand for an independent state of Nagaland. They were led by Angami Zhapu Fizo. In 1954, the Naga National Council announced the establishment of an independent federation of Nagaland. In 1955, skirmishes happened between local Nagas and the soldiers of Assam Rifles. Military action was taken to suppress the skirmishes. Several rounds of discussion took place between the central government and the Naga National Council. Central government decided to give the Naga majority territory the status of a union territory. The Nagaland was made a full-fledged state on 1st December 1963 by putting together the Naga majority territory and part of Tuen Sang. Leader IS in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai, Suhas Sargar. Assam. In 1983, there was an intense agitation staged by all Assam students. Union and Assam Gana Sangram Parishad over the question of the dominance in Assam of Bengali migrants in 1985. In 1985, Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi, Central Home Minister Shankar Rao Chavan, and Assamese leader Praful Kumar Mohanto signed an accord. It was decided to send the Bangladeshi citizen who had infiltrated in Assam back to their original places. In 1986, elections were held in Assam Legislative Assembly and Prafulla Kumar Mohanto of the Assam Gana Parishad became the new chief minister. Due to his democratic process, it became possible to establish the peace in Assam. Arunachal Pradesh, in 1954, NEPA was created. In 1972, it began to be called Arunachal Pradesh, region of the rising sun. On 20th February 1987, it got the status of constituent state. During the period from 1960 to 2000, Northeast India had progressed towards the more mature democracy. This area is on the path of progress through industrialization, spread of education, etc. Leader IAS, in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai, Suhas Sargar. Naxalism, Naxalites movement. These movements started at Naxalbari in Darjeeling district in West Bengal. The Naxalites organized as small landholding farmers and land laborers and took the charge of their lands, put up a red flag and declared that area as free territory in 1967. All those movements that took inspiration from these rebellion are called Naxalites movement. The movement had objective of establishing the action committee to raise a voice against the exploitation of these farmers by the landlords and to confiscate the land of the landlords and distribute it among the tenants. Later, the movement strayed away from its objective. It took recourse to terrorism to prevent any government scheme and welfare policies from reaching the common people. The Naxalites started a parallel system by rejecting the democratic system. This made Naxalism a serious challenge to India's internal security. The movement was mainly located in West Bengal. Later, the movement spread to East Godavari in Andhra Pradesh, parts of Visakhapatnam, Karim Nagar in Telangana, Adilabad, Bastar, Rajanandangav, and Sukma in Chhattisgarh, Gadchiroli, Bhandara, and parts of Chandrapur in Maharashtra, Balaghat, Mandala in Madhya Pradesh, Koraput in Odisha. In order to maintain their influence, the Naxalites established the organization called People's Liberation Guerrilla Army, and this conflict is still going on. Communalism. The communalism is a serious threat. Communalism is a serious threat to the unity of our country. Communalism emerges out of the narrow religious pride. The British sow the seeds of communalism in our country. People of different religions have happily lived together since many centuries. There is nothing wrong in people of different religions living together in a country while being duly proud of their own religion. But when this pride becomes excessive, then it turns into bigotry. Each one of them begins to consider their religion superior and others inferior. This led to the religious fantasism. Fantasism is the base of communalism. It makes one oblivious of national interest. The people of different religion don't trust each other. They become suspicious of each other. Competitors following different religions are looked at as an enemy. Even commensality or the coming together on festivals become rare. As a result, it became difficult for everybody to come together and get organized for their demands and civil rights as a citizen. Fantasism makes the perspective of looking at the events and people prejudice. Some people began to think of economic and social questions also in the framework of their own religion. Some people of all religion think that since they belong to a particular religion, they have no influence in politics. They begin to believe that they are being treated unjustly. They hold the idea that government is partial against their religion In such a condition, they become too sensitive about their religion and their co-religionist. If anybody speak about the people of their religion or insults the religious symbols, knowingly or unknowingly, the riots break out because of this kind of thinking. Hundreds of innocent people are killed. The public property worth crores of rupees is damaged. The public peace is destroyed. Due to the bitter memories of the riots, the peoples are estranged from each other and mutual trust receives setbacks. The trust between the people is the basis of coexistence. If the trust breaks, the social unity receives a blow. How can national unity be achieved without social unity? Hence, it is necessary that we all counter this religious communalism with all our strength. For this, we should mix with the people of different religions. We should accept the good practices and ideas of each other. We should be able to look at and understand our economic and social problems rationally. We should not mix these questions with the religion. We should search for economic, political or historical reasons that are responsible for disturbing religious harmony. This is the only way to put an end to communalism and strengthen the national unity. Regionalism. Regionalism means having excessive pride about one's region. It is one thing to introduce oneself as a Bengali or a Marathi person. But if I think that because I am Bengali or a Marathi, I am a superior to others from other provinces, it can be termed as excessive regional pride. The love for one's province turns morbid due to this kind of the excessive regional pride. It is a natural to feel love for one's province, but it should not become abnormal. Leader IAS in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai, Suhas Sargar. Regionalism thrives on regional imbalance in development in the post-independence period. Some states achieve more progress while some states remain backward. For example, states like Maharashtra, Gujarat, Punjab, Tamil Nadu develop economically and industrially, whereas the states like Odisha, Bihar, Assam remain undeveloped economically and industrially. Economic development and reforms are the foundation of progress. As a result, the state that develop economically can also achieve the progress in other areas like education, health and culture. The states which have not developed in this manner remain backward in education and civic amenities. The opportunities of development available to the people in the developed state are not possible for people in backward state. They are harassed by problems of education, backwardness, unemployment, poverty, etc. They began to think that they are being cheated. They are being kept away from benefits of development. Because of these, the understanding between states is broken, and this in turn has a negative impact on the national unity. The economic imbalance that has endangered this understanding needs to be set right. Our government make efforts in this direction. Regionalism can affect development as well as undeveloped states. The people of developed state begin to believe that they are superior due to their superior history and culture, and hence they have developed that much. Then they begin to look down upon the people of underdeveloped region. They are not willing to share the benefits of development with the backward state. On other hands, the people from backward areas need to arouse their regional identity to organize themselves. For this, they try to unnecessarily glorify the local traditions and cultures to prove their uniqueness. This leads to regionalism. It endangers national unity. The evil of regionalism can be tackled by reducing the imbalance in development. We have studied a few challenges that India has facing. Apart from these, there are the several problems like overpopulation, cleanliness, agriculture, and the problems of farmers, poverty, housing, and food. We are trying to overcome these and move forward. We are progressing steadily. In the next chapters, we shall learn that progress in the economic field. See the map of India, our country. This is all about this chapter. Leader IAS, in association with Yashas Academy, Navi Mumbai, myself, Professor Suhas, thanks for listening.